welcome. My name is Eleni Mastea, and I'm the director of the International Studies Institute. And it's always an honor, it's always a pleasure to be welcoming you to our special Contemporary Jewish Studies lecture series, one a semester, and always sends us home with a lot more connections as well as a lot more knowledge than we had before we came. And I would be asking Dean Pisani to introduce the speaker, Professor Tanisha.
While Dean Pisani will do the proper introductions for our speakers, for our speaker today, Professor Jonathan Israel, for the Contemporary Jewish Studies lecture series. I also want to announce or to remind you that Professor Israel will also be leading a colloquium tomorrow from 12 to 1:30 at the Historic Commons Room in the Mesa Vista building. And the theme for that is Radical Philosophy in Revolutionary Times, the American and French Revolutions Compared. The colloquium is open to all, and it will be a short presentation and then questions and answers from the audience that will include some faculty, some students, and people from the community. As the director of the International Studies Institute, I also want to announce or to remind you, if you are receiving our announcements, that today at 5:30 p.m., we have another lecture. That one is part of the Power of Place lecture series. So at 5:30 in the auditorium of the Architecture Building, you are all welcome to come and hear a lecture by Professor Jeff Malpas, who is coming from the University of Tasmania and is a premier philosopher of Heidegger. His lecture is titled Place, Space, and Modernity. And if you want any more information after this lecture, I'll be outside and give you more details if you would like. And for now, I'd like to thank again Dean Pisani for coming to introduce our speaker and for his ongoing support for the International Studies Institute. This is on the record.
And for the record, I'd like to thank Eleni for all the wonderful work that she does for the Institute and for the University. Thank you very much. We meet here at an interesting time for the United States of America. And because we are the most powerful nation in the world, our interesting times will be shared by people around the globe in a variety of ways that are difficult to predict. But the questions we're facing as a nation today are, in a sense, timeless questions. How do people from different races, ethnicities, genders, religions work together, find common purpose, or at least tolerate one another? And as we struggle with these things as a nation, I can't think of a better time for the talk that we'll have today. Because the things we are struggling with are things that societies have struggled with since there were societies. And Dr. Jonathan Israel of the Institute for Advanced Studies at Princeton and the School of Historical Studies. Would you like to rename the History Department the School of, or the Department of Historical Studies?
Me?
Yeah. I just saw the chair walk in, I thought. Nice name for a department.
You know my college together.
And he is, Dr. Israel is an expert on Europe and European colonial history from the Renaissance to the 18th century, and his recent work focuses on the impact of radical thought on the Enlightenment, on the emergence of modern ideas of democracy, equality, toleration, freedom of the press, and individual freedom. His books include European Jewry in the Age of Mercantilism, The Dutch Republic, Its Rise, Greatness, and Fall, Radical Enlightenment, Philosophy, and the Making of Modernity, Enlightenment Contested. He's actually published 14 single-authored books and at least a half dozen edited volumes, more than that, in co-edited volumes. And I counted about 350 different articles, book chapters, review essays, and other publications. We have a tremendous scholar with us today, and a scholar who has been struggling with the intersection of ideas, ideals, power, and great powers, and how those things intersect in European history. And today, he is going to be sharing with us the experience of Dutch toleration in the 17th century that brought Jews for the first time into the mainstream of modern Western society. But as is often the case, not with full emancipation or full rights, but more than was the case before, and opened the door for additional expansion of rights, responsibilities, and opportunities. And the story that he will tell us today is one that I hope will find some wisdom for trying to figure out how we as a society cope with a lot of these same issues as they connect in the United States of a Trump presidency. I probably shouldn't have ended Trump presidency before bringing our guest, but please join me in welcoming Dr. Johnson.
Well, thank you very much for that kind and too kind, probably, and graceful introduction. I'd like to begin by saying how glad I am, and my wife feels the same way, she's with me here, to be in New Mexico and to be in Albuquerque today. We've just come from Santa Fe and very much enjoyed that, and the whole New Mexico experience is something which is very, very special for us. Now, this is a large subject, of course, and I had to truncate some of the earlier parts. So, in fact, I'm not going to say very much about the Dutch or even toleration as such. I want to focus specifically on Jewish emancipation and begin by pointing out what an enormous transition that actually is. I don't think it would be in any way unreasonable to say that Jewish emancipation was the single biggest change in modern Jewish history since the Reformation and Renaissance. It was not just a question of legalities and legal status and political status. It's not just a question of the equality of a religious minority in relation to majority groups in society. All those things are important, of course. But what we're dealing with here, you must remember, is the move away from a very hierarchical society, which highly stratified not only in terms of social groups, where some groups had a great deal more privilege and access to power than others, as well as a great deal more wealth, but a society in which theology and religious status defined certain groups as being in established and defined other groups as being in a strictly subordinate status. And what this meant in practice, if you just think for a moment, in the early modern period, so in the 16th and 17th and still in the for most of the 18th century, disabilities on religious minorities and other kinds of minorities for that matter, there were huge disabilities, for example, on homosexuals and gays, but that's a whole other subject. But just looking at religious minorities, the disabilities that applied to the Jews were special. They were excluded from all guilds, all professions in most European countries, or the Netherlands was an exception to some extent in the 17th century, but generally speaking, and even in the Netherlands, they were excluded from all artisan guilds, from all crafts, from all professions, and from all office holding, all political status, all academic positions, and so on, all the professions, in fact. So, in other words, European Jewish society down to the emancipation consisted of two groups, Affluent merchants come financiers in Germany and some parts of Europe. Many of them were, of course, moneylenders or involved in finance, the more affluent richer Jews, but who were a minority. And the majority of the Jewish population were simply peddlers or vagrants and hangers-on or community servants, living off charity maybe. Many of them had nothing at all and were simply vagrants. There were also a lot of Jewish criminals around, it has to be said, in the 18th century, which is hardly surprising in a social framework such as this. Just take Germany, for example, which of course has been one of the most important foci of Jewish life in modern times. If you start in 1780, at the beginning of the process I want to describe in the lecture today, the picture I've just drawn is exactly what you see, a small affluent merchant group with some financiers and a large Jewish mass who are absolutely have no skills, no crafts, no artisans, no professions, no occupations. Got it? And within 70 years, just imagine, within 60 or 70 years, once emancipation begins to take effect, the Jews enter the academic world, higher education, the professions, there are lots of Jewish lawyers and journalists. Journalism is almost overrun by Jews in Germany by the middle of the 19th century and by the later 19th century. Many, many professions. So such a dramatic change, such an enormous change can be described as a revolution. It is the social and cultural revolution. And it also helps to explain why there is such an enormous sense of grievance and resentment about this in German society. Suddenly, this group, who everybody thinks of as utterly marginal, absolutely inferior in every respect, invade all the professions and higher positions in, apart from government and professorships, I must say. Till the 1860s, the Prussian government did succeed in keeping the Jews out of professorships in Germany, but by and large, the transformation was absolutely staggeringly fast and staggeringly conspicuous. So we're talking about one of the most important things in modern Jewish history. This is the most important thing, I think. And when you place Jewish emancipation within the wider framework of Enlightenment-related reforms and changes at the end of the 18th century and beginning of the 19th century, so the universal and equal rights, the idea that the political status of the non-affluent person should be equal to that of the affluent person, all the constitutional reforms and other political changes, the idea of freedom of the press, etc., etc., etc. There's a tremendous transformation at the end of the 18th century, beginning of the 19th century, of which Jewish emancipation is part, which is the biggest revolution of modern times, of course. So there is the in the history of Western modernity, this is the most important change. So since all of us here, of course, and lots of others, needless to say, are intensely interested in this issue of the most important transformation in the history of Western modernity, of course, Enlightenment has to be absolutely central to our thinking. So Enlightenment happens to be the focus of my own work, but it is actually the most important issue for all of us insofar as we're interested in the history and indeed the destiny and fate of Western modernity. So Enlightenment is central for everybody here, whether they realize it or not, it's slightly different, but it is absolutely central and pivotal for everybody here. And therefore the difference between moderate Enlightenment, which is let's say the mainstream of the Enlightenment that wanted to challenge theocracy, religious sway over society and the old forms of government, but not change the social structure too much and keep the aristocracy running things. That's the moderate Enlightenment. And most of the great thinkers and great writers like Voltaire and Hume belong to that mainstream. And on the other hand, there's a radical Enlightenment, which I'm going to be saying quite a lot about in relation to Jewish emancipation, because I see it as the most important factor, the key factor in making it possible. Radical Enlightenment was fired by the idea of democratic republicanism, a democratic republicanism that thought that all men and women had the same right to pursue happiness in the way that was right for them, therefore to make up their own minds about, you know, what religion to have, how to lead their life, how, what political views to hold, etc., etc. In other words, the kind of Republican vision that Thomas Jefferson, for example, in the United States was so famous for at the end of the 18th century. This becomes part, very much part, of the Enlightenment debate in the late 18th century. And this kind of thing, we can easily relate to it within a United States context by thinking, who were those figures during the American Revolution who emphasized and advocated a democratic Republican outcome? So people like Tom Paine, Thomas Jefferson, Franklin, actually, in his last years, Benjamin Franklin, very much part of this radical Enlightenment, whereas the other group in the American Revolution, the other group of founding fathers, John Adams, Hamilton, and Gouverneur Morris, and so on, what they wanted to keep the aristocratic Republican model. They were against, we don't want democracy, we don't want equality of status. There shouldn't be equality of status. A few rich guys should run the United States. So there's already a big ideological conflict in the 1770s and 1780s, which is, you'll see, I hope I can bring this out clearly, is directly related to this theme that we're discussing this afternoon. So, for the history of Western modernity, the 18th and early 19th century has a particular special significance. Now, to understand the early stages of the process of Jewish emancipation, which starts in the 1780s and goes on down to the, let's say, the middle of the 19th century, in essence. And to grasp it correctly, one has to realize that a framework of ideas that makes possible the idea of Jewish integration into society on the basis of equality with everyone else, and the Jews being absolutely equal in their rights and opportunities to everyone else, is not at all possible without a degree of secularization and change in thinking about political forms and economic forms as well, which more or less involves doing away with the whole traditional framework of society, how society was organized and its hierarchical format, and also must involve some changes in relationship between church and state, because under all the old recipes and ways of doing things, such a process as Jewish emancipation would be totally impossible. What this means, and I'll go on to my second slide now, what this means is that the framework of thinking that made Jewish emancipation possible, this radical Enlightenment framework, is the work of a small group of Enlighteners and publicists and journalists very often, and an intellectual elite, if you like, and it is not in any way a part of a wider cultural process characterizing society as a whole. This is very important because historians in recent years have been very much captured by what, in my opinion, is something of an illusion that a form of cultural and social history which puts a lot of emphasis on changing mentalité of the ways of thinking of society as a whole. So, for instance, some scholars at the moment try to explain the invention of universal and equal human rights at the end of the 18th century in terms of a very broadly diffused process in society. You know, everyone was, through reading novels and through new forms of sociability, allegedly, a new awareness of things gradually grew up in society, and this had the effect of both of secularizing and making everyone a bit more tolerant of other groups than their group than they had been before. Now, this way of thinking, which is nonsense in my own opinion, is actually very widespread. Many colleagues adhere to this way of thinking about things, but I don't think it works in general when we're talking about the reforms of the late 18th century. And I think Jewish emancipation is an excellent example of how utterly hopeless this this kind of cultural, social way of explaining change in the Enlightenment period in terms of sociability and gradual cultural change accommodating the whole of society, how completely wrong that is. As I say, no better example than Jewish emancipation. Now, the first time in a political sense or a legislative sense, any of the major governments in Europe considered maybe altering the status of the Jews. They were not thinking of emancipating the Jews in England. I don't think that. That wasn't the idea that was in Parliament's mind. In the middle of the 18th century, this slide on the screen at the moment is a tract by John Toland, which I think is actually the earliest example. For those, perhaps the date is not very, probably you can't see the date. It was published in 1714 in London. Toland is one of these radical Enlighteners. He was not at all interested in or committed in any way to Christian belief or allegiance. He had a very secular view of society. He thought that all groups should be equal under the law and under the government. So he put forward the set of arguments as to why Jews should be allowed to become naturalized citizens on the same basis of others. And Parliament did in fact consider this very briefly, and there was a debate in 1753, and a bill was passed not to emancipate the Jews. They certainly hadn't got as far as that in England in the 1750s. And in fact, England is not at the forefront of this process of Jewish emancipation after this particular experience in the 1750s. But they did think a bill came before Parliament, which was known popularly as the Jew Bill of 1753. It was thought, well, there are quite a lot of individual Jews who've got a lot of money, who are contributing to England's overseas expansion, who've got expertise of various kinds that is of value to the British Empire and to the British Crown. Wouldn't it be, most of the Jews, of course, shouldn't be given any rights at all, but shouldn't a few of the elite, at least, be on an individual basis given the opportunity to become individually naturalized as English citizens on the same basis as others? So Parliament passed a law for about 6 months allowing this, and there was a tremendous uproar in English society. People were absolutely horrified. How could such a terrible idea be passed by government? And this is a very complicated slide, but it's one of the... is published by opponents of the 1753 Jewish Naturalization Bill, and it's deriding the idea of a society in which the Jews are allowed to enter all professions and positions. So, and it's imagining how England would look in 100 years after such a bill was passed, 100 years later, with Jews occupying all kinds of prominent positions, how this would defigure English society. Anyway, the outcry was so enormous, and this is what I want to emphasize. Ordinary opinion, the common populace were totally against this. There's absolutely no indication at all that there was the slightest sympathy for such a thing. On the contrary, overwhelming hostility. And this is exactly what you find in France and Germany later as well. So I don't think there's any reason to think that slow, gradual changes of a broad social, cultural sense within society, I'm not saying that they weren't slow, I'm just saying that they don't fulfill the kind of role that is often attributed to them, and I don't think they're of very much relevance when it comes to, I wouldn't say no relevance, but I don't think they're of much relevance when it comes to the question of Jewish emancipation. Now, I'm going to spend a large part of the remaining time for the lecture talking about what I see as the turning point in the process of Jewish emancipation, the turning point in terms of thinking and ideas, which, as illustrated by a famous, renowned, deservedly renowned debate and which grew up in the 1780s, partly around a very famous text published in Germany, which I'll say something about at the moment, by Christian Wilhelm von Dohm. Especially I want to focus on a prize essay competition which was held by the French Academy of Metz in the later 1780s, which illustrates all the different angles to the debate and acted as a kind of focus for the debate as a great Enlightenment drama, which indeed it was. So the Metz Prize competition in the late 1780s was a key episode in the build-up towards Jewish emancipation. And this process in the Royal Academy of Metz was initiated by this gentleman, Pierre-Louis Roederer, who was to be a prominent figure in the French Revolution, a prominent ally of the Democratic Republicans. That's very, very important. He was an ally of Brissot, who I'm going to say something about in a moment, an ally of Mirabeau, who I'll also be talking about. These are the leaders of the Democratic Republican tendency, and which was one of three, just to oversimplify and be abbreviate very much, but the French Revolution, you have to understand, is really a battle between three different ideologies which were totally incompatible with each other and which ruled each other out and which fought each other bitterly, fiercely, and uncompromisingly. So you mustn't confuse them. You've got to try to distinguish them in your mind. So one of them, it was very much like the aristocratic republicanism. Remember John Adams, Jay, Gouverneur Morris, Hamilton, that kind of thing. Well, the monarchians, the moderate monarchists within the French Revolution, who made quite a strong bid for dominance within the French Revolution during the first two or three years, certainly down to 1791, were a very powerful force. This is the moderate Enlightenment, if you like. Then there are these democratic republicans who were trying to have a much broader French Revolution, and they were the ones who were behind not only Jewish emancipation, but black emancipation and ending slavery in the French colonies. Not just ending slavery, because England also ended slavery a few years later. It's not just a question of ending slavery, but the idea of elevating the blacks and integrating them on an equal basis into French society and into society generally, which is a much wider and more ambitious project. The very principle of universal and equal rights, which was talked about quite a lot in the 1780s, but of course is made into law, legislation, by the French National Assembly in August 1789. These are tremendous changes, not just for France, but for the whole world. One of the most important things in the history of Western modernity, absolutely tremendous changes, and of course Jewish emancipation is very characteristic of this and very much integral to this process. So it's a particular group of people who think not only differently from the vast majority of Frenchmen, that's one point that is presumably clear to everyone now, and very differently from the vast majority of people in England and from most people in America, come to that, but that's another question, as well as Germany, but also think very differently from the two other ideologies, or the two other groups within the French Revolution. So the aristocratic republicans. The other one, which perhaps does indeed have some relevance for our present predicament in the United States, and even perhaps more in Europe today. Remember, we've just had Brexit. We've got some rather ugly trends in France today, in Hungary, in Poland, in various European countries. There's plenty to worry about, perhaps more to worry about in Europe than in the United States. In any case, there's a lot to worry about on both sides of the Atlantic. And I think that this third ideology, which starts to raise its head in 1791, 1792, but only captures power within the French Revolution in June 1793, that is the authoritarian populists. Now, the people who, the thing about the group, the following of Marat and Robespierre in particular, Danton was very much hesitant between the democratic republicans and the populists. But Robespierre, of course, became, and the people who organized the terror in 1793-4, they were the leaders of the populist authoritarians. And what they, their main criticism of the democratic republicans was saying, why do you need freedom of the press and all these different ideas, and why do people have to be taught about all this enlightenment stuff anyway? That what is legitimate in politics is the ordinary person, the really ordinary person, and the more ordinary the better. And if you're genuinely ordinary, there's only one right way of thinking. Okay, so you don't need freedom of the press. So we shut down all the newspapers. That was one of the first things they did. And anyone that criticizes the people's government, the populist government, ought to be executed. So then you start the terror. And of course, some people think the terror is just about beheading aristocrats and a few clergymen. But I assure you that they started by executing the democratic republicans. And Roederer had to hide for a couple of years. He would have been one of those guillotined if he hadn't been quite clever in hiding. Now, Roederer, that's the center of Metz as it was in the late 18th century. The town hall you see there at the end, this Metz became very much amongst French provincial cities, one of the ones with the most active academy and actively involved in Enlightenment debates. He was prominent in local commerce and industry, an expert on legal issues, and a member of the regional Alsace-Lorraine High Court, the Parlement. But he was very critical of the whole Ancien Régime legal structure in France. He thought the whole structure was, all it did was to protect privileged groups' property, really. If you were a person without property and without privileged status, then the law didn't protect you, it didn't offer you anything at all. What's the use of a law like that? Which is, if a legal system is geared only to the protection of vested interests, then it is not something which is in any way geared to the happiness of mankind in general. And Roederer wanted something that was much more reasonable and much more radically enlightened than that. So he wanted to more or less abolish the whole legal structure in France well before the revolution, as all these group, all these individuals that I'm talking about did, the ones who initiated the movement for Jewish emancipation in France. He was dissatisfied, Roederer was dissatisfied with what Voltaire and other philosophers had to say on the Jewish question. And it was Roederer in particular who initiated the famous prize competition at Metz. The competition was, so the Metz Academy announced the competition in 1785. The question was, and whoever wanted to enter the competition could. You had to write an essay, a very long and detailed essay with plenty of footnotes, and the panel of judges would decide which was the winner. There could perhaps be several winners. There were to be three winners, as I shall explain. But the essay question set was, is it possible to render the Jews happier and more useful in France? That was the question. And now, Brissot was one of the most important of the democratic republicans, one of the most important leaders of the Amis des Noirs, of the Society for Ending Slavery and for Elevating the Status of the Black Population in the French colonies and in France itself. There were quite a lot of mulattoes and blacks in Paris, actually, by 1789. And he was one of the most important leaders of this radical Enlightenment group who were interested and committed to the principle of Jewish emancipation. Now, what they were doing, these French leaders of the this movement for Jewish emancipation, was following on from a debate which took place slightly earlier in the early 1780s in Germany. And what Brissot did was to publish in 1784 a very important review article, a long review article of Dohme's text. I come back to Dohme again in a moment, saying pointing out how important it was to raise this question of Jewish status in Europe and Jewish emancipation. in the whole, we can see that in proposing this essay competition, that Roederer was quietly suggesting that there was a need for a revolution in Jewish life, a revolution which should be conceived as part of a general break with tradition, with conventional thinking, with the prevailing religious ideas, a break that should come to Alsace-Lorraine in the first place, but was needed in France more generally, and thirdly, in the Western world as a whole. So it was part, the debate, the Metz Academy debate about Jewish emancipation was seen as part of a wider debate about the nature of the reforms that were needed to transform Europe and the Western world into the kind of society that these radical enlighteners had in mind. Now, Brissot, in Donne's text, for the first time, you have a frank acknowledgement of the extreme narrowness of the social frame for Jewish society, the disfiguring effects this had on Jewish society itself. So Donne, he approaches this in what he thinks of as an objective way. He thinks there are many defects in Jewish society. But what is really innovative and a breakthrough in terms of Jewish emancipation is his claim that this situation is highly unfortunate and disadvantageous for the Jews. It's highly unfortunate and disadvantageous for society, and it's basically the fault of the churches and of Christian society. This is what Donne says. You could put some of the blame on the Jews for certain features which he discusses, but the main blame has to lie with the churches and with Christianity. So that is a very, very new approach. Dome is willing to be a little bit kind of cautious and qualifies some of his remarks quite a lot, whereas Brissot, in reviewing the book, drops all the caution and says, that's absolutely right. It's ridiculous the position the Jews have been in, all the fault of the churches and Christianity. Brissot was a very uncompromising kind of democratic Republican, so he forgets about the cautious phrases in Dome's. The whole thing's totally the fault of the churches and Christianity, no question about it. This is a very, very emphatic, a very effective journalist in the revolution, Brissot. His paper, The Patriote Français, was from the fall of the Bastille in July 1789 till the point that those populist authoritarians, Robespierre and his friends, shut it down and arrested him in the summer of 1793, that paper, The Patriote Français, was one of the most important in promoting democratic reforms. It was a very, very important paper. Now, from the point of view of discussing Jewish rights, and Brissot was trying to tie in his criticism of a society and a way of thinking, theological ways of thinking, which had caused this situation of Jewish distress with all the other things that he saw as being wrong in France. So he's very much against monarchy, very much against aristocracy, very much against black slavery, particularly passionate on that point, very much against the way that the legal system supported an economic system which left the majority of the French people without any money, really, and living in conditions of considerable poverty, whereas the elites of French society lived in great affluence. Now, of the three eventual winners of some of the essays that were sent in response to the Metz Academy prize competition were regarded as extremely good. In fact, the judges took 3 or 4 years, and an enormous debate developed about which were the best arguments and how they were going to respond to. They got more interest, perhaps, than they were expecting, and Roederer was, of course, influencing the panel behind the scenes. And of the three entries, quite interesting, one was by that were given a prize at the end of the three entries that were considered the prize winners by 1789. One was the famous churchman, or a liberal churchman, Henri Grégoire, who was prepared to break with the bishops and episcopal authority, break with Christian tradition in quite a number of ways. Gregoire was a very important example of a Catholic reformism, but of course there are certain things that he didn't want to say and that he wouldn't agree with Brissot about. And ultimately, it's clear that Gregoire did want the Jews, when emancipated, to convert to Christianity. So he was one of the winners, Henri Gregoire. Second one was Thierry, a lawyer. I won't say much about him, although his essay, which I read with great interest a couple of years ago, is also very fine, an excellent essay on Jewish emancipation. It's very important to make the Jews equal members of French society, to remove all the disabilities on the Jews, the social, the cultural, the religious, all the disabilities should be removed. And Thierry repeats the arguments of Dohme and Brissot. Yes, the reason why Jewish society is so savagely disfigured and has so many defects, is so narrow in its scope, is the fault of general society, and in particular it is the fault of the churches and of Christian tradition. So Thierry, although he is a Christian, he or at least from a Christian background, agrees with that. But the third winner, very interestingly, is somebody called Salkin Hurwitz, a Polish Jew who had been wandering about in France with not very good jobs at all, though he was lucky enough in the late 1780s, he did get a good position at the Royal Library in Paris a couple of years before the revolution, because they needed someone who could read Hebrew, Aramaic, and a few other Oriental. He was a very good linguist. He knew other languages as well as Hebrew, Aramaic, Polish. He came from Poland. He knew other, and French. He knew other languages too. He was an excellent linguist, so he did get a good job at the Royal Library eventually. Salkin Hurwitz. I wonder, who in the audience has heard of Salkin Hurwitz? Just as a matter of interest, has anyone heard of him? So I think that's an indication, given the very high level of our audience here today, that Salkin Hurwitz is not very well known, despite being one of the three winners of the Metz Prize competition of 1789. I think, from my studies, that this man, this Polish Jew in France, Salkin Hurwitz, is the first example of something that became very important in the world, not just in Jewish life, in the 19th century. He's the first example of a secular Jewish revolutionary who's got plenty of very harsh things to say about Catholicism and Christianity and the churches, but has got equally harsh things to say about rabbis and about the way that Jewish communities are organized. He's a real revolutionary who wants the Jews to be equal to everyone else, for universal and equal rights to become the rule. He makes a number of remarks about the failure to move towards black emancipation as well as Jewish emancipation. And he was an excellent journalist and had a certain style of humor. I'll read out one or two of his jokes in the closing minutes of my lecture. But Salkin Hurwitz was the third leading entrant, and was at the end of this process was declared one of the three winners, and under the auspices of the Academy of Metz, all three of the winning prize essays were published and made a big impact, inevitably, on the later stages of the debate about Jewish emancipation. Now, in terms of the radical way in which he presents his view on Jewish emancipation, Salkin Hurwitz, like another secular Jewish commentator of the late 18th century who had rather a lot to say about this debate in the Caribbean, David Nasi, who was a leading figure in the Jewish Enlightenment in Suriname, in Dutch Suriname, at the end of the 18th century, was much closer in his views to Brissot, to Roederer, and to Condorcet, that's to say very uncompromising in his rejection of tradition, of ecclesiastical sway, and of the way the royal government and legal system in France functioned, rather than Dohme, who was the writer who made the biggest impact as regards Jewish emancipation in Germany. Now, so here's the title page of Dohm's very famous pamphlet, which is actually the booklet that set the whole process moving in the 1780s, Über die bürgerliche Verbesserung der Juden, Christian Wilhelm Dohm, published in Berlin in 1781. Now, we know that it was partly at the prodding of the great Jewish philosopher Moses Mendelssohn that Dohm published this pamphlet, and so and Dohm was not a Christian, but he didn't announce the fact that he didn't believe in Christianity privately. He was a deist and a republican, but he was working for the king. He was a royal official in Prussia, so he was in quite a strong position to publish this. But as I said, he was very cautious and qualified his remarks and was careful in how he expressed it. And Mendelssohn, as a Jewish thinker, of course, he needed somebody like Dohm to act as a front man, because a Jew couldn't come along and say, look, the situation of the Jews in Europe is absolutely terrible, and very drastic and far-reaching changes are needed. How could any Jewish representative do that? That was important. That was impossible, even though Moses Mendelssohn did have an exceptional amount of individual personal prestige, which other Jews didn't have in the late 18th century. It would have been impossible for any Jew to be seen to be precipitating this process. So Dohm could only do it, Mendelssohn could only do it by having a figure like Dohm in the forefront, Dohm was not actually a Christian, but people didn't know that. They thought that he was a Christian, so that served to function as an effective front for the opening stages of Jewish emancipation. So, there's a portrait of Dohm. What a pity we haven't got a portrait of Horowitz, otherwise I'd be delighted to show it to you, but we haven't got one. That now brings me to the question of opposition to Jewish emancipation and to the role of important churchman, the Bishop of Nancy, Henri de la Fare. In the debate over Jewish emancipation, La Fare played a leading role in opposing it in France, both before 1789 and during the early stages of the revolution. Remember, there was a lot of resistance for 2 years. It wasn't till 1791 that the National Assembly finally passed the legislation, the decree, that made all the Jews in France equal citizens of the French Republic with other citizens. There was a great deal of opposition to it. And this opposition came both from counter-revolutionary people, so ultra-royalists who were totally opposed, always totally opposed. It was one of their key arguments. These revolutionary people are absolutely terrible. Look at what they're doing. And one of the things they're doing is freeing the Jews from all the disabilities that they're under. So the counter-revolutionary people, which included a large part of the French clergy, but by no means all the French clergy. A large part of the clergy were prepared to go along with the moderate Enlightenment people, with the aristocratic republicans, as long as they protected church interests and the position of Catholicism, special position of Catholicism, to a certain extent, which people like Brissot and Mirabeau were actually not willing to do. So, La Fare was one of the main spokesmen, not only over the Jewish issue, but over the general question. In August, there was this huge battle in the National Assembly over the decree of the rights of man and the citizen. Should there be universal and equal rights of man? Is that a basic principle of modern morality, politics, and society? Should modern society be based on this principle? The answer of most people in France in 1789 was a resounding no. And we mustn't forget that. There's only a small minority of radical reformers who are pushing this, who want to bring this in. It's not something, it doesn't have support from the established elites, or the aristocracy, obviously, or the church, and there's no real support from underneath, from the populace, from the people either. That's the point. So this is why you have to put you. I think that, you know, in all our minds, we've got to distinguish between moderate enlightenment and radical enlightenment. Radical enlightenment is absolutely pivotal, as you can see from what I'm saying, I hope, for the unfolding of Western modernity. If you haven't got a clear view, if you don't know what it is, if you're not clarifying your thoughts about radical enlightenment, so make a note, radical enlightenment, absolutely fundamental, you are missing something so crucial that you can't really have a clear picture of what, of how Western modernity came about and what its roots are. Anyway, Lafargue was a very eloquent spokesman who, he said, okay, well, you won't listen to, I'm the Bishop of Nancy, I've given you these theological arguments, you won't listen. You say that the church shouldn't have the role that it has had in France. You say the law supports our position with all these disabilities on the Jews. You won't listen. You say that the entire legal system has no validity, no status, no prestige. It doesn't deserve to be respected. Only your Enlightenment opinions should be respected. But will you listen to this? He said, Nancy is not far from Metz, as many people will know. It's in the it's in Lorraine, of course, so it's part of this Alsace-Lorraine area. Lafargue made a point saying, I know the people of my region. You can't imagine how they detest the Jews. Don't do this, because you're going to cause an absolute uproar. There's going to be so much trouble, they are going to they will rise up in arms and they will slaughter the Jews. These terrible things will happen. Don't do it. This is Lafargue's view about the Jewish emancipation question in the early revolution. And equally, well, his approach, he was clever. He was going with the moderate revolution. He's one of the prominent figures and chairman of the sixth bureau in the National Assembly. He tries to not to block universal and equal rights completely, but to qualify the clauses on freedom of the press and one or two other clauses in order to retain a special privileged position for the Catholic Church. What about freedom of the press where you can criticize everything except the Church? Will you take that? And that's basically his line. Well, I must wrap up now. It's time to close and to get on with the, I hope there will be questions and that people will bring up some of the issues that I've been touching on. But let me just wrap up the lecture by running through some of the dates, the basic chronology which characterizes this emancipation process. So in 1714, John Toland published his reasons for naturalizing the Jews. He's a Republican who's very much opposed to the more moderate ways of thinking, Lockean tendencies within the Enlightenment. 1749, Lessing is another one of these radical-minded people who's interested in the idea of not just reforming society generally, but in helping bring about an emancipation of the Jews. So Lessing's play on the Juden, 1749, was very important. 1753, this amazing situation where the British Parliament passes the Jew Bill, allowing selective individual naturalization, which causes such an uproar from the common population in Britain that in November 1753, the massive anti-Semitic outcry led to Parliament deciding to rescind the Jew Bill. 1781, publication of Dohm's Über die bürgerliche Verbesserung der Juden, and another Dietz, I didn't get time to fit him in, his another German radical, very interesting figure, more radical than Dohm, actually, Heinrich Dietz, who also played a part in this, the Emperor Joseph II. So you see, there's a big gap between the sort of thing that the Austrian, there was no, in the time of enlightened despotism and the Enlightenment, there was no political figure in Europe who was prepared to go as far as Joseph II in introducing reforms. But even he, you see, only would go so far. And there's a very big difference between Joseph II's toleration patent, which gave much more freedom for the practice of the Jewish religion and for forming Jewish communities in Austria, Bohemia, and the whole of the Austrian Empire than had existed before 1781. But but toleration is not the same thing. Obviously, there's a very big gap between toleration and full integration with equal rights, equal legal, political, and economic rights, which is a very different thing. So Joseph II's toleration patents tolerate, but they do not emancipate the Jews of the Austrian Empire. It's very important to be clear on that point. So 1785, August, the Metz Royal Academy announces its competition with it wanted the essays in by 1787, but it couldn't make up its mind, or it had a lot of work to do judging the excellent essays that came in. 1787, Mirabeau, who was the most important leader of the radicals in the National Assembly and of the opponents of people like Lafar, Mirabeau was one of the main promoters of universal and equal rights and of Jewish emancipation. Of course, the two things obviously are closely related. He published an important pamphlet on Jewish emancipation too, called Sur Moses Mendelssohn's Sur la réforme politique des Juifs. That's 1787. And it was in 1788 that the Metz Academy announced the three prize winners. And for the first time, a Jew, Zalkin Hurwitz, was in this way acclaimed as a leading figure in Enlightenment debates, which apart from, well, it happened with Mendelssohn, but in France that hadn't happened before. And then in 1789, not only does the revolution begin, of course, and the Bastille fall, but all three of the Metz prize-winning essays on Jewish emancipation were published for everyone to read. Thank you very much for listening. And I hope very much that there will be some questions. Yes, please.
Without any way of finding criticism here, but what of the Jewish community's view of all these actions? I mean, you mentioned a few well-known intellectuals, but the wider Jewish community, what was their take on all of this?
Yeah, very good question. Well, it very quickly became clear that the people who supported this movement for Jewish emancipation, whether they were deists, Christians, or Jews, as in the case of Mendelssohn or Zalkin Hurwitz, or David Nassi, a very interesting figure in Suriname, and a number of leading Jews in Holland as well. It's actually amazing. I have a particular knowledge of the Amsterdam Jewish community, that there was a very deep split. Only by the 1790s, it was a public and universally visible and clear, obvious split with the rabbis, the panasim, the community leaders, and the majority of the community on one side opposing the emancipation measures because they didn't want to see the community organization dissolved. And opposing closer, by that time you had the Batavian Republic, which and the more democratic elements wanted a closer alliance with revolutionary France. And the Jewish community leadership and rabbis in Amsterdam didn't. But a very important break-off group who formed a separate, that they were not necessarily anti-religious, they were more what we would call liberal or reformed Jews. They had a slightly less observant approach to Judaism, and they formed a breakaway synagogue actually in 1796. But people like Moses Salmon Asser and other leading figures in the Dutch community, often younger and more liberal-minded ones, were very supportive of this. So in Holland, in Germany, in France, in everywhere, a deep split came about in Jewish life to begin with. But remember, this Jewish emancipation process was extended often in a forcible way. I mean, Napoleon conquered Italy in 1796 and 97, and he said, Napoleon, who supported this Jewish emancipation movement, just said, well, that's it, the ghetto's finished. Remove all the walls, all the disabilities, the whole lot. The Jews have to sit on all the committees because they're citizens in the new Italian republics on the same basis as everyone else. So whether the Italians liked it or not, whether the Italian Jews liked it or not, the Jewish emancipation was imposed in 2 years by 1797 on Italy. And that was the end of it. The ghettos were finished. And it was, again, very divisive in Jewish life, but it was so beneficial to a large, or let's say to the majority of the Jewish population, that opinions rapidly began to change, and the same in Germany. And as I said at the beginning of the lecture, many, many people benefited from this. So when the Allies finally defeated Napoleon in 1815, and a new reactionary period set in, and they tried, the Prussian crown and other German governments, for example, tried to go back and reverse the process of Jewish emancipation, shut them out of many professions. This then caused a great deal of, as you can imagine, of a highly educated, westernized in our modern sense, Jewish grievance and resentment, which is, in my opinion, is the reason why certain individuals, Jewish individuals in the early middle 19th century, people like Heinrich Heine or Karl Marx, have this extremely uncompromisingly critical, rejectionist attitude to German society. I think that's the source of it. yes, please. It's very hard to hear you. Could you perhaps stand up and try to talk louder?
Oh, you want to hear better? I'm sorry. I've read a bunch about Napoleon supposedly being in favor of emancipation of Jews, but was it truly his philosophy, or was it more like he was at came in at the time when it was a fait accompli already, so to speak, so he said, let's just stick with this, or
Did anyone hear it better than me who can explain the question? I missed some of it.
Did Napoleon really want to emancipate the Jews, or was he just taking advantage of a thing that had already pretty much
Napoleon, of course, was an opportunist who was trying to build a new power structure. He wasn't necessarily a man of principle, but many of the people around him were, including his own brother, Louis, who became king in Holland, or his other brother, Joseph, in Spain. And Napoleon had lots of enemies. So using Enlightenment reforms as a way to create a new social and political system in Europe was a very important part of Napoleon's power system. Now, there are cases like his, for instance, cancelling the abolition of slavery in France in 1802 and reintroducing black slavery in the Caribbean, when he thinks that that ignoring the principles of emancipation would somehow extend his French empire, because he was hoping to build up the French empire again in the Caribbean. That all went wrong because of the fighting in Haiti and yellow fever, which wiped out his army and other things. So that was, in fact, when he was on St. Helena after his defeat, he said that his ending of his reversal of the abolition of black slavery and his policy in Haiti was one of his biggest mistakes. So he regretted it later. But as far as the Jews were concerned, whether Napoleon was in Italy, whether he was in Malta, where he immediately did the same thing, whether he sent his men to the Ionian islands of Greece, as Eleni will confirm, that Jewish emancipation in Greece begins in 1797. Why does Jewish emancipation in Greece begin in 1797? Because Napoleon's soldiers arrive in Corfu and say, that's the end of it, no more ghettos, you've got to put the Jews in the city council in proportion to their numbers in the population. This caused great trouble because the Greeks, of course, didn't like this. And the French, I've actually myself read the reports of the French police chief in Corfu for 1798 and 1799 on the situation in the parts of Greece that the Napoleonic troops have occupied. And he said, we've got a number of problems here, but the biggest problem is Greek resistance to Jewish emancipation. They absolutely refuse to accept that, and it's causing fights and difficulties and problems all over the place. The battles in the theatre, which the French established in Corfu, and so on and so forth. Napoleon, and the same in Egypt. Napoleon was always very consistent on this, Jewish emancipation was always one of the elements of his particular statecraft and of the new political social system which he established in Europe.
Yeah, you described the situation before the French Revolution, But I wonder...
Excuse me one moment. Is there a mic for the audience? Because it's very difficult for me to hear what the questions.
So you described the situation before the start of the French Revolution. Yet, after the French Revolution, I think the situation was a little bit different between England on the one hand and France and Germany on the other. Because in France and Germany, somehow the line, the reform also occurred, and the Jews felt that they had not to show that they were Jews, somehow to secularize themselves, while there was no such difference was in England, where there was no real reform taking place. This is
The
second question is about whether you believe that somehow some people think that the new modern anti-Semitism started right with some of the enlightened figures, such as Hume and Voltaire. And if that is.
Two very interesting questions, one about England in relation to the continent in this context of Jewish emancipation, and the other about the views toward the Jews of Voltaire, of Hume, and other leading figures, because starting with Arthur Herzberg, and also several scholars in France, since the 1970s and 80s, we've been aware that a new kind of anti-Semitism begins within the Enlightenment itself during the 18th century, which is certainly true. Well, as far as England is concerned, after the, although it might have been, as it were, towards the front of this process in the early stages in the early 18th century, from partly in reaction to the French Revolution, also partly in reaction to the American Revolution, I have to say, you can already see this reactionary mood arising in England in the 1770s in reaction against the American Revolution. Britain becomes a very conservative and even rather reactionary and repressive society by the 1790s. And they really, whether it's whether it's the subordinate position of Ireland, whether it is protests against aspects of British rule in Canada, with the one exception of abolishing the slave trade, but which was of course a major exception. But in general, Britain was not prepared either before 1815 or after 1815 to tolerate anything that smacked of challenging aristocratic. The point about the traditional British constitution made Britain an aristocratic republic. And no one was allowed to challenge this. So, I mean, this idea that England was a land of freedom of expression, all that, is very exaggerated for this period. Tom Paine's The Rights of Man, for instance, was effectively banned in England all the way through from 1791 until the Great Reform Act of 1832. So I would say for 40 or 50 years, Britain was a pretty repressive place, as many other parts of Europe were. So nothing much could be reformed, or more accurately, nothing was reformed except for in relation to the slave trade. That was an important exception. And Jewish disabilities, at least in theory, remained in place to the middle of the 19th century. So, for instance, Jews couldn't get degrees at Oxford and Cambridge because no one was allowed to get a degree at Oxford and Cambridge unless they swore an oath which included not just acknowledging their belief in the New Testament, but certain things which involved identifying with the Anglican Church. So English dissenters also often mostly didn't take degrees at Oxford or Cambridge till the 1860s. I forget the exact year that it changed, but it's not till the second half of the 19th century. So England was rather behind in the process after 1789. And as far as the... with Enlightenment, again, I think this commitment to Jewish emancipation is exclusively a feature of the Radical Enlightenment. It's another example of how... I don't think one understands anything about the Enlightenment unless you're get it clear in your mind. There's a mainstream enlightenment, and there's a radical enlightenment, which is quite different, which was an underground movement until about 1770. Even in the 1770s, it was still had to use various forms of screening, so that their texts were usually published anonymously, for example. They still couldn't fully, identify themselves as the people who were responsible for these ideas, because they were considered so subversive, so challenging, and so irreligious that it would expose the authors to serious retribution if they were too obvious. So the radical enlightenment is something very different from the moderate enlightenment. This has been stressed by a few scholars, but most scholars don't put any emphasis on this, which is why I think there's so much confusion about issues precisely like this. So Voltaire, for instance, was certainly one of those who helped generate the new secular anti-Semitism in the 18th century. Voltaire's remarks about the Jews are extremely hostile. There's no question about that. But as Salkind Horvitz, who's very funny, I didn't get time to read out any of his jokes, he's quite funny on this subject, he says, Voltaire's remarks about the Jews are terrible. Nevertheless, here he's not joking, he's being very serious. Nevertheless, the Jews owe Voltaire an enormous debt, because the moderate enlightenment did more than anything else to weaken old attitudes and views and prejudices, and nobody did more to weaken the sway of churchmen and clergy over European life than Voltaire. And that because he did so much to weaken the sway of the clergy, the Jews will always owe an enormous debt to Voltaire, and I think he's absolutely right. Any other questions? Eleni.
I was thank you very much for enlightening us. I think it's what you said within 60 or 70 years, some women have to face the Jewish and their society is wrong, and that what flaws are going to fall. And I'm wondering, what was the inside education? How did the community itself prepare them for taking birth?
Yeah. So Eleni's question is about education, and I think it was it's very clear reading the prize essays on the one the Metz Academy competition that all three of the winners and the judges, two for that matter, could see that education was going to be the critical issue. And I described Salkin Horvitz as the first secular Jewish revolutionary, and he was revolutionary in that he wanted to dissolve the rabbis and communal control over the way families organized their lives, and that included how children were educated. He wanted the Jewish children to be educated together, with all the children should be educated together in state schools, with no clergy of any denomination or any description controlling the education system, but the purely secular education system. And in this way, Christian, Muslim, and Jewish children would grow up together to understand that they share the world together, that they are basically the same, that there are no essential differences between them. There might be minor differences, but there are no basic differences, and that they have the same rights, and they have equal rights, and that children can only learn this in that way. So, and this is one of the main reasons why, you may say, well, why were the rabbis and community leaders willing to oppose the Emancipation? Isn't this paradoxical and a strange contradiction? But I think education in particular, but also the wider question of community control over Jewish family life and religious authority, that the rabbis' religious authority would count for much less if this Emancipation process went ahead. And I think that these are the reasons, but education was one of the most important why the communities became opposed to the Emancipation. Not entirely opposed, as I tried to explain. There's a very deep split in the Jewish community. These splits you see in very widely dispersed. There was a bitter split in Suriname. There was the Sephardic community in Curaçao divided also in the early 19th century, and so on. There are a lot of divisions of Jewish communities over the emancipation question and the status of the rabbis in Jewish life.
What was the literacy rate for the general population of France and Germany of the non-Jews versus what was the literacy rate of the Jewish community?
Well, literacy rates in the 18th century are very high in Protestant societies in particular. So especially in Calvinistic ones like New England or like Holland, say, or Scotland. In societies like that, the at least three quarters in Holland, they estimate 80% of men could read and 60% of women. Now, in Catholic countries, the rates were lower, but they were increasing steadily in the 18th century, so that we know in France, although the proportion of illiterate was still very substantial, but as a very rough guide, something like half of adult men could read a bit. Whether they could read a complicated political pamphlet is another question, but enough people could read these political pamphlets to read them out to groups. So there's no question that, I mean, this is one of the reasons why the French Revolution happened in 1789 and not in 1689, because in 1789 there were a lot more people who could read these tracts and pamphlets out to groups of people, so that these ideas were diffusing much more widely. Thank you.